Shared adventures always are better adventures. Join me for a hot Brazilian paragliding XC adventure. We will cruise under cloud streets, fly with friends, and ultimately it will all end in frustration. But first we'll have an awesome flight. So I have just launched off the famous launch in Quixada in the northeast of Brazil. And we're trying to climb out at this beautiful rock that sticks out of the plane. So it's the first thermal in the morning and I'm just trying to climb as high as I can in order to limit the chance that I just bomb out right behind launch. There are other pilots climbing under this good-looking cloud just in front of me. So I'm trying to push over in order to catch this cycle and also climb to base underneath this cloud. So it's early and in the flats it's all about cycles. So I do worry a bit that I already have missed the cycle because usually they're not very long-lived. But I am in luck and the cycle is still here, so I can climb up to base relatively quickly. Usually I try to fly straight a little bit before base in order to not get sucked in. I still touch the cloud a little bit, but it's nothing to get worried about. So in front of me there's my friend Danielle and we're heading towards this small cumulus clouds in front. It's difficult to tell if they're still working or if they're already dead, but we are in luck and I can start climbing. Danielle sees me climbing, so he's also joining me and together we start going up towards cloud base. I always super much enjoy it flying with friends and it's just shared adventures always are better adventures. We are climbing back to cloud base together. I always like to do my turns quite tight and really stay in the core. This helps me to maximize the climb and brings me back up to base faster. While I turn, I always challenge if I'm really in the strongest lift. So I'm trying to push to the right or to the left and always see if I can actually optimize my climb. In a way, I'm quite an impatient pilot, so I think I can always climb better. Now we are back up to base and we're all ready to go on glide. I try to link up as many of these small cumulus clouds that I can on glide in order to maybe find another thermal, but also in order to just optimize my glide and profit of even small lift that might be still existent underneath these clouds. I have found another thermal and I start to climb and I'll try to take this back up to base because you can see there's quite a bit of shade around, so I'm still flying quite conservatively. There's also Danielle that joins me and together we ride the bottom of the cloud base and profit of the good lift of these clouds. The key to cloud-based flatland flying is to understand the life cycles of clouds. You want to be there when it's still active. So that means if you have a good, well-developed cloud in front of you, it's often too late. So I'm often trying to head to these small kind of wisps that are just coming up and start to develop. Because there you have still the chance when you reach it that it's still active and brings you up. When I get low, I turn my focus more towards the ground. And we are running into a situation here where it's all covered in shade at the bottom. So I do something that I normally don't do and push against the wind in order to fly towards the sun. And I'm focusing on the cloud up here. So you can see it's not a super uniform cloud. So it's difficult to tell if it's still alive or not. But it has a thermal underneath. And as we continue to climb, it gets more dense towards the left. So I actually push over to the left in order to profit of the strongest climb possible. Usually where the cloud is most dense, there is also the strongest climb. I'm back up on cloud base and I'm going on glide. In front of me, there's quite a big blue hole. This is typical when you have mountains and terrain that is sloping downwards, where the wind is just coming over the mountain and flowing down this downward sloping terrain. There you can expect very few thermals. On the other hand, when the terrain is going up and the wind is blowing up the terrain, there is often good thermals to be found. I'm running into a similar situation as before, so there's a lot of shade on the ground. So I do aim straight for the sunny patch underneath. And I'm fortunate enough that there is actually a thermal that comes from this sunny patch that brings me back up towards cloud base. I don't know if you have noticed, but you can see kind of the wind direction from the shades of the clouds on the ground. And I do aim always or often a bit crosswind if I want to try and find thermals, because when you just go with the wind, you can cover less thermals as if you go a bit crosswind, because then the wind kind of transports the thermals to you, whereas if you just fly straight downwind, the wind blows the thermals away from you. I do find here another thermal. And watch the good-looking cloud that is downwind of me. This is really the cloud that you want to be underneath. But I told you before, when you see this kind of perfect clouds, it's often too late. So by the time you will reach it, it will already start dying. And this is exactly what happens here. So when I get underneath it, there is absolutely no more thermal and the cloud starts falling apart. That's why I often aim for the smaller clouds that are still developing. This is some beautiful flying around the clouds. And I'm cruising underneath the cloud base in order to optimize my glide. So I go a bit left and I go a bit right off the course line, just in order to collect as many of these good looking clouds as I can and optimize my glide. You can see the clouds are quite dark. They have quite a flat bottom. So that usually means they are still working and there's still at least some lift. So there might be not a strong thermal, but there still should be some lift underneath that you can profit off. Again, I'm running into a situation where I get low and there is all shade around. So I orientate myself again on the ground and I'm heading for this little lake, which are often good triggers. And there are different theories to why this is actually the case. So it can be, for instance, a difference in temperature from the water to the land mass. Then there are also, of course, the lowest point, so it's a bit protected from the wind, so the kind of warm air can build up before it releases. But I'm not sure why this actually is that lakes can be a good trigger in the flatlands. Maybe you have another theory, so comment and let me know if you have a better explanation. I do get low, it's all shaded in, I'm getting desperate for a thermal. I do spot some urubus, which are Brazilian vultures, in the distance, which are actually climbing. So I head for this kind of gaggle of birds. And there is a climb, but it's weak. I turn with the birds, it's drifting, but there is this smell of landing in the air. And soon enough, I lose my climb and I actually have to think about the landing. So usually in windy places, I always like to have plenty of space downwind. So I do face into the wind to judge if it is strong, but I find, hey, it's not very strong. So I aim for a landing closer to the road in order to walk less. And yeah, then it's pretty much game over and I touch down. There is not so much wind. I manage to put my glider into the only bush that is on the landing field. I'm all a bit frustrated, but hey, the cool thing about paragliding is when you land safe, you can always try next time. I hope you enjoyed this video and learned a ton.